Greetings from Talent Battle. Hello everyone, I am Rohit. Welcome to our new video. In this video, we are going to solve the previous year coding questions for Accenture Drive. This video will help you to prepare for it, and also you can join our masterclass training where we are going to cover all the previous year questions. Also join our social media handles like Telegram groups, Instagram page, WhatsApp groups. We are constantly updating the placement related information and updates of on campus and off campus too. Links to all these handles is given in the video description. So before we start, don't forget to subscribe our YouTube channel and press the bell icon for instant notification about our videos. So let's start with the actual content. So the first question in this video, we have to solve this as it is a coding question. So what is given? You are required to implement the following function. The function name is also given. So if you check, the return type of the function is integer. The name of the function is count specific numbers, and it is going to accept two arguments. Both are of integer types, integer m and integer n. The function will accept two arguments, m and n, which are integers. You are required to calculate the count of numbers, right? So we have to calculate the count of numbers which are having only 1, 4 and 9. So this will give me idea about the condition. So you should read the question carefully. You will get everything which is given as their digits between the numbers which are lying in the range of m and n, both inclusive. So whatever the value we get as an input for m and n, including both, we have to identify the count of numbers which includes 1, 4 and 9 and return the same count. So we have to return the count from here. And if the value of m is greater than n, we have to return minus 1. So the given conditions, suppose m value is 20 and n value is 50. So what we have to do in between these two numbers, 20 and 50, all the numbers which includes 1, 4 and 9, we have to identify. And whatever is the total count of all these numbers which are satisfying this condition, that count we have to return here. And if the value of m is greater than n, right? Say for example, m is equals to 50 and n is equals to 20. So it satisfies the condition m greater than n. In such case, what we have to do? We have to return minus 1. So all the possible cases and the conditions, we have to cover whatever is given in the problem statement. So I will suggest that read the problem statement carefully, understand everything, whatever is given, and then you can develop the logical flow and then write down the code. So coding will not take much time. Understanding the problem statement is more important. They have also provided sample input here, 100 and 200. So value of m is 100 here and value of n is 200. And the sample output is 9. Means we have to check how many numbers are there which includes 1, 4 and 9 as well. Say for example, 1, 1, 1, 1, 4, 1, 1, 9, 1, like this. So all these numbers in between 100 and 200, including these two also. Whatever the total numbers we will receive after applying that logic, the final count should come. And here the expected output is 9 here. Now see, the explanation is also provided. The numbers between 100 and 200, both inclusive, which are having 1, 4 and 9 as their digits. Say like this, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 4, 1, 1, 9. So all the digits you have to check, right? 1, 4, 1. Like this. So you can check all the numbers which are having the digits 1, 4 and 9. Now 100 is not taken here. The reason is 100 is inclusive actually, but the digits are not matching with the condition, whatever is provided. Again, same is applicable for 200 also. So we are not including these numbers. Only the one which are satisfying these conditions, which are having 1, 4 and 9 as their digits between the numbers lying in the range. Now what will be our approach to solve this particular question? First step, you will take the input from the user. Now as discussed, the function name is also given. So take input in the format of m and n, whatever the input is given. Then do cross check the condition, whatever the conditions they have mentioned. So specifically, first we need to maintain a count variable, which will be initially 0, right? So maintain count variable. Count is equals to 0. After that, you will be having a for loop which will traverse from m to n, right? because we have to check the given range also. So take a for loop traversing from given input, that is our m and n. So like traversing from m to n. So once you traverse throughout this for loop, you will be checking whether my particular number, whatever is coming from the user, right? So initially I will assign number variable is equals to I. I is my ranging from, I ranges from m to n, right? I ranges from m to n. So I will utilize this value because I have to take the modulo division also for calculating all these numbers, because I have to check for every particular digit. So that's why the logic of modulo division will work here, right? So my next step will be utilize a modulo division and a normal division also to reduce the number. So modulo division and normal division to reduce the number up to digit, single digit, and then check the condition whether it is equals to 1, 4 or 9. If it is equals to 1, continue the process, right? Otherwise you have to stop the process. So we can use break and continue here keywords that will check, and at the end increment the count which are satisfying. So this is a repetitive case. So under a while loop, all this logic will work, and the condition to check, logical or condition, you can check in if that my number is equals to 1, or number is equals to 4, or number is equals to 9. In this way, we can check the logical flow of that. Now, I hope you understand the entire logical process, how you understand the problem statement, and on behalf of that, whatever the flow you decide. So once you understand all this flow, coding will be easy because all these steps are now in front of you. You have to just follow these steps and make sure that all the provided test cases are satisfied. So let us move on to the coding part. So I will be writing the code out here and we will be checking the output as well. Okay. So I will be writing the code in C++ so that you will understand the entire logic. So first step, just include the header file iostream. After that, include the namespace. So this is for our standard input output object cin and cout. Then they have mentioned the function name also, so I am writing the prototype of the function, integer count specific numbers. This is already given, count specific number, and it accepts two arguments as mentioned. So I will be taking that integer m and integer n. So this is just a prototype declaration. So I will be writing the comment also so that you will understood this is prototype declaration of the function. After that, let's take the main function, and inside the main function we will be writing entire code and calling this particular function also. So as discussed, first we have to declare the variables m and n, or both are of integer types, then accept the input, right? So I have accepted two values here, m and n. Then I am calling the function count specific number and pass these values of m and n as an argument to that function. So m comma n. What this will do, this will pass my control to the function body. So we have to write down the function body as well. So first I will complete the main block. Then I can write down the function body here. After main I am writing it. So it will be possible for compiler to analyze because already we have declared the prototype. Otherwise, what is another option? You can write down this body upper part of the main function, that will also work. Then write down the function definition, count specific number, which will accept two argument here. So this should exactly match with your prototype declaration, and inside the body I will be writing down the logic what we have explained, right? So first I will check the condition. If my m value is less than equals to n, if this is true, because for greater than we have to return minus 1, but for less than we have to write down our entire logic. Then I will be taking some variable, initially I is there, and count variable as discussed will be initialized to 0, and we will be having a for loop which will start traversing from m to n. So my I is initialized to m, I less than equals to n. Why equals to is taken because it is mentioned in the problem statement that both the values are inclusive. So that's why we have to take that, and then I plus plus. Inside that, first I will assign my num variable that is having value of I, because I will be processing that value. So that's why I have taken one more variable, and I will maintain a flag variable just to cross check the condition. Initially it is initialized to 1. Then I will be utilizing while loop, and in this while loop I will pass my number value. So for this particular number I will be utilizing the logic of modulo division and normal division to reduce it up to particular digit. So num modulo division 10 and number is equals to num by 10. So due to this, what will happen? The number will get reduced to individual digits, and after that I can check the condition what is mentioned. If my number that is been actually stored in n is equals to 1, or number is equals to 4, or because this is given in the problem statement, so we can write it down like this. Either or, no? Either it should be 1, either it should be 4, or either it should be 9. So that's where logical OR condition is utilized. And here I can continue the process. So what will happen due to this? If the number, whenever it is reduced to the particular digit, and if that digit consists of either 1, 4 or 9, it will continue the same process. So my while loop will go on working. Otherwise, if suppose after performing the digit consideration and still my number is not satisfying the condition, so I will be maintaining the flag value to 0 and I will break the process here. So that no need to check for further, right? So you can stop the operation in this case. Then I will check if my flag is equals to 1, because flag will be 1 when the number is satisfying the condition, and if it is not satisfying the condition, it will be 0. Already I have initialized it to 1, so I will check the condition. If flag is 1, we have to increment the count variable, right? And after this I will be returning the count, because this is my actual output. The count we have to maintain, but as mentioned in the problem statement, if it is not satisfying the condition of m less than m greater than n, if it is m greater than n, this condition is given, then we have to return minus 1 from here. Clear? So this will be my total logic. Step by step I have explained the things. Just try to map this with the logical discussion what we have. Now let us execute this. And what is the sample input they have provided? First sample input is 100 and second sample input is 200. So value of m is 100 and n is 200, and output expected is 9. So let us cross check for this. I will be compiling and executing the code. See, now it is syntactically correct, so no errors are there. Logically we have to check by passing the inputs. So now it is waiting for the input. So first input is 100, second input is 200. So value of m is 100, value of n is 200, and the expected output C 9. It means it is satisfying our logic what we have explained, and it is also satisfying the provided test case also, right? In this way you have to convert the given problem statement into the coding part. So first part was accepting the input. Right, here we are accepting the input, and whatever the conditions they have given, we are checking it here. So first condition, we are checking it here, condition check, and the condition of m greater than n will be finally results into return minus 1 if that is the case. Okay, so let's execute for that part also, whether it is working or not. Suppose my m value is greater than n value. Suppose I am giving 200 and 100. Right, so it is returning minus 1. So that logic is also perfectly working, right? So I hope you got the logical flow and the conditions why we have taken, and it is satisfying the provided test case also. So you got the final output, that is 9 for the provided input. Let's move on to the next question. So read it carefully and try to develop the logical part. Understanding of the problem statement, whatever is given, is more important. Once you understand the given input, easily you can solve the question. So second problem statement is, implement the following function. The function is also given here. Again, the return type of the function is integer, and it accepts three arguments of integer type: integer a, integer m, and integer rs. So you have a basket full of apples and mangoes. Your job is to make the number of apples and a given a function that will accept three integers a, m, and rs as its argument, where a and a basket respectively, and rs is the rupees that you have. So basket and rupees, these things we have. Implement the function to balance the basket. So we have to write down the code for this function that will balance the basket on the basis of value of A and value of RS, that is rupees. The conditions are also given. If the value of A is greater than value of M, then you are going to buy A minus M mangoes. See, this is the given condition. Once you analyze this, you can utilize it in our program also. At the rate is also given, that is rupees 1 per mango. And if second condition, so first condition, condition 1 is A greater than M. In this case, what we have to do? We have to perform A minus 1 and rate will be rupees 1 per mango. Rate is rupees 1. And what is my second condition given? Condition 2, A is less than M. Then we have to sell, right? See, when A is greater than M, you have to perform buy operation. And here you have to perform sell operation. See, it is mentioned here. And if the condition is A less than M, M minus A mangoes will be there. And again, the rate is given as rupees 1 per mango. So rate is same for both the cases, but the conditions are different. If A is greater than M, we have to do A minus M. And when the condition is A less than M, we have to do M minus A. And return, what is the expected output? We have to return the total rupees which are left with you after balancing the fruits. So that is my expected output. See, what are the assumptions or constraints which I have provided? Value of A should be always greater than or equals to 0. So you have to take this into consideration while considering the input. M is also greater than or equals to 0. And rupees is also greater than or equals to 0. As well as final values will be also greater than or equals to A minus M. If suppose the condition is A is equals to M, whatever the values you take as an input, if both are same, then you have to return the rupees which are unchanged. Because then there is no calculations of greater than M and less than M. So that's why the same value you have to return. What is the sample input given? Value of A is 8, which is greater than or equals to 0. M is also 4, which is greater than 0 again. And RS is 6. So this is our given rupees and these are the values of A and M. So now we have to check two conditions as mentioned. First condition is A greater than M. So for the given input, let us check 8 greater than M. M is 4. So yes, this condition is true. If this is true, what we have to perform? A minus M. So I will be performing A minus M, which results into 8 minus 4, that is 4. Right? But what kind of operation I am performing? Buying operation. And what is the rate that is given? That is 4. Understood the condition, right? And whatever the rupees they have been provided, right? That is 6. So on the account of rupees, I will be considering the condition because A is nothing but the basket, right? And RS is the rupees that we have. So if I am working on this condition and if I consider this as a rupees part, RS, so it will be 6 minus 4, that is equals to 2. So the output should be 2 in this case because we have to buy. Right, we have to buy because this condition is satisfied. Vice versa case, if A is less than M, in that case, we will be performing the selling operation. Right. So this will be the logic. So code is very simple because only two conditions are given over here. And inside that, we will be working on the sample output. Say for example, my value of A is greater than M as mentioned here in the given input. So A minus M mangoes are going to get bought. Right. So rupees is equals to, how you will calculate the rupees? 6 minus 4 is equals to 2. So the output is 2 in this condition, right? Because here it is mentioned, right? Rupees is equals to A minus M if the condition is going to get satisfied. So let us move on to the coding part of this. Again, I will be writing down the code in C++ so that it will be easy for you to understand the case. Now, our consideration of the case on the basis of provided input is given. So, three integers we have to take. So, first I will add the header file, then namespace, then writing down the function integer main. As they have mentioned the function part also, so we can just put the function into the respective case. What is the function name? Balance fruits. So, you can write it down under the category of balance fruit and you can call it similarly what we have done, right? So just make the prototype declaration here, integer balance fruits, and three arguments it is accepting, value of a, m and r s, integer a, integer m and integer r s. So this is again the prototype declaration. Inside main, just first accept the input integer a, m and r s. Three inputs we have to accept. After that, just call the function balance fruit and pass this values of a, m and r s respectively, then return 0, right? Now you can utilize this function balance fruits and it will accept three arguments, integer a, integer m and integer r s. In that respective case, you can check the condition. If my value of a is greater than m here, then I will be just printing the case calculations of rs, rs minus a minus m, sorry, small m, right? Otherwise, another condition can be like this, else if a is equals to equals to m. Generalize, you have to write down the code, so we have to consider all the possible cases. In that case, they have mentioned whatever is the RS value, you have to as it is display it, as it is return it, no unchanged value will be there. So I can directly display the RS value. And my last condition will be calculations of else if my A is less than M, right? So I can write down that condition also, else if A less than M. And inside that, I will be calculating my Cout RS plus, because it is a selling part, right? So M minus A. This will be my logical flow, so that it will return out all the cases, right? So let us check for the provided input. What was the given input? 8, 4 and 6. So three inputs it will accept. So syntactically it is correct. Now it is accepting three inputs, 8, 4 and 6. So now it is returning the calculations on the basis of RS, but we have to little bit modify the program on the account of that. So let's cross check the values again. Okay, so got the idea that what was happening in our earlier logic, we have actually called this function balance fruit from cout statement. Means we are trying to print the result here in the main. But what I have written earlier, I try to print the result here also, in the body of the balance fruit. So what we have to make only, just whatever the calculations we got on the basis of given condition, just return those results. Instead of printing it here, return those results to the main function and there you will get the output for this. So one modification you can do, instead of printing it here, what we were trying to do in the earlier case, just make sure you make it return from here. So I am calculating a greater than m. If this is the condition, then return rs minus a minus m. If a is equals to m, same rs value unchanged, we have to return. And if the value is a less than m, then we have to return rs plus m minus a, right? Now let us cross check this. So my first input was 8, 4 and 6. And I am expecting the output to be 2, right? See the condition. Input is 8, 4 and 6. And my sample output is 2 over here, right? So only the modification of the code was done, like instead of printing out here, because multiple that will case, right? Because we are returning some value. You can have that logic also, instead of, if you don't want to return from balance fruit, print the results here, then no need to have the cout statement here. Just call the function. That modification will also work in both the cases, right? So let us cross check for equals to condition also. If the value of a and m are equal, suppose 8, 8 and 6, then it is returning the same value of rs, that is 6, which is unchanged, right? In this way, you can apply the logic. So coding is easy if you understood. If once you understand the problem statement, you can easily do it, right? So I hope you understand all the both problem statement and the logic of it, how to develop the coding part. Don't forget to subscribe our YouTube channel. Thank you.